All right, guys, welcome back. Hope you had a good spring break. We are starting on a new concept, the French Revolution, which coincides with the Enlightenment that we learned about a few weeks ago and the American Revolution. As you can see, this was 1789, which is a few years after the American Revolution had ended. And as you can see in that picture there, that is a representation of the French Revolution. When someone says the French Revolution, your mind should automatically go to that picture there with a guillotine, somebody with their head up under it, and a basket, because they did a lot of head chopping during this time of point. So, as a matter of fact, the guillotine got a nickname during this time called the National Razor. It was like their Statue of Liberty, in a way. So let's move on. Let's talk about some causes that led to the French Revolution. So, of course, we just talked about the Enlightenment. The Enlightenment is one of the main causes of the French Revolution. You've got these ideas coming from these learned men who were totally against absolute monarchy. And they were wanting to create their own governments. And they came up with these ideas, like the ideas of John Locke and Montesquieu and Rousseau, the ideas that they could govern themselves. Voltaire, with his ideas of rights, like the right to believe whatever you want to believe, the right to say whatever you want to say, things that are protected in our Bill of Rights. So the Enlightenment. Number two, y'all remember Fat Louis. Louis the 14th. Well, the great-grandson of Fat Louis is Louis the 16th. And he becomes king in 1774. And he's really not a bad guy. He just isn't really smart. He's actually kind of slow. And Louis, along with his cousins all across Europe, basically at this point in time in history, are the examples of why you don't intermarry. Why you don't marry your cousins, okay? Because your children gonna be slow. And this is what has happened. Remember, when royalty in Europe has to marry other royalty in Europe, by the time we get to 1774, you get cousins marrying cousins. And after a while, you get slow kids. And not Louis' issue, of course, because he was born into this, but he's not real smart. He marries his cousin, Marie Antoinette, which is the daughter of Maria Theresa of Austria. So she is from Austria. She's not from France. And they are running the country at a very critical time in France's history. If you remember, King Louis the 14th, Fat Louis, left a lot of debt and issues. And it only carries over to his great-grandson. And so they have got to rule France at a critical time when a great leader is needed, and he's not going to be that great leader. Economic problems are mainly the issue of their woes. Louis and Marie were brought up as spoiled little brats, basically. They got everything they wanted. Marie had never gone without, and she has such an extravagant spending attitude that she gets a nickname, Madame Deficit. As you can see there in the picture, she loves new hairdos. Yes, that is a boat in that woman's hair. She would have a new hairdo almost every day of the week. And of course, that wasn't cheap. Not only that, she'd have her stylist and her dressmaker come in, and they would make new dresses for her and her friends. She would throw parties. Marie loved to throw parties. She liked to have the champagne flowing, desserts galore. She loved pastries, and she liked to gamble. Now, she sucked at playing cards, and she wasn't very good, and so she lost a lot of money. But it didn't matter because it wasn't hers, and she didn't care that she was losing the money. And so she was fueling some of these economic woes. Other issues, cost of living was rising in France. They had some weather issues for a few years where some crops were killed by hailstorms. And so not only that, there was job loss here, job loss there. Louis decided to help out the United States in, or the American colonies in the American Revolution, which led to more debt for France. And it ends up going to cause a revolution in his own country. But the poor grain harvest, because of those storms that kill the grain harvest, they have issues with bread. And bread makes up 75% of the peasants' diets, those that are poor. And so when they can't get their bread because they're having to pay three-fourths of their wages to buy the bread, they start starving to death. And so these economic problems are going to lead to major issues. So here's a video to show you just how extravagant Miss Marie Antoinette was. You see all the fabric. This is from a movie known as Marie Antoinette. And this is basically the life that they lived, day in and day out. Putting a diamond necklace on a dog while peasants were starving. This is the way they were living. Here comes the hairdresser. That girl was extra, very extra. But think about how they had to pay for all this, all the taxes that they had to bring in. And who was paying all of those taxes? Here's a little French Revolution in a nutshell.
Of the modern state. So, how did this all begin? For hundreds of years prior to the revolution, French people, like most Europeans, were divided into three social estates: clergy, nobility, and the lowest estate, the commoners, which existed to serve the other estates. Above all was God's gift to mankind, the king. But this hierarchy was being questioned by the Enlightenment, a movement of intellectuals who promoted the use of reason and science. revolutionary ideas began to spread to the public. So, in the 1780s, when an economically broke and spoiled monarchy tried to increase taxes on the commoners, resentment reached a new level and riots began. On the 14th of July, 1789, revolutionists stormed the Bastille Fortress, a symbol of the royal power. This date is marked as the beginning of the end of the old monarchy, has become France's Independence Day. Even though the king was beheaded only in 1793. Shortly after, the French adopted a universal declaration which stated, men are born and remain free and equal in rights. This was a radical change, even though it left many people out. But the French Revolution was far from a smooth ride. Actually, it was a bloodbath which led to external and internal wars. The newly introduced guillotine worked overtime, beheading tens of thousands of French during a period known as the Terror. In 1799, the revolution ended when a military commander by the name of Napoleon Bonaparte seized control of the French legislature, eventually declaring himself emperor. Although the revolution began and ended with a monarchy, it had a crucial impact on Europe and world history, and laid the foundation for a modern state governed by the people.
Alright, so that's just the revolution in a nutshell. We've got one more cause to go over. And it is not the last, and it's definitely not the least. Well, it is the last cause, but not the least cause. But the unfair political and social system that was set up, like it talked about there at the beginning of the video, where the majority of the population were peasants or working people that had to pay a lot of taxes. They had hardly any, if any, voice in their political system. And this system was known as the Old Regime. The Old Regime was divided up into three estates, and you need to know all three of these estates and who were in them and who paid taxes. So the first estate's the clergy, your religious leaders, okay? So clergy, at this point in time, we're still talking about the Roman Catholic Church in France here. And so you've got your archbishops, your bishops, your cardinals, people like that. That's the clergy I'm talking about when I'm saying the first estate, because you've got other clergy like the priests, the monks. They're not a part of that. Okay, they are the ones that actually side with the third estate. You've got the second estate, which is nobility. Those that are born into the royal family that aren't kings and queens. They are nobles. They hold titles and a lot of land and a lot of money. And then, of course, number three, the third estate. The third estate is going to be the bourgeoisie, which is your middle class workers, your lawyers, doctors, business owners, people like that, and then your peasants, those that are your day laborers working on the farms. They're begging for food in the cities. They're doing all the grunt work that people don't want to do. Let's talk about this. The first estate, the clergy, like I said, it's mainly the higher clergy, your wealthy aristocrats. They've bought their positions in the church. They're corrupt. They're really not holy at all. They more likely they're there because of money and position. They have nothing to do with actually what God wants them to do. They probably could care less about the Bible and the extent of the church and what the church does for people. Then you've got the lower clergy. They're the ones that are your village priests, your commoners that are siding with the third estate. So the clergy, like I said, very wealthy, very powerful. They own about a tenth of the land in France, but they hold a quarter of the wealth of France. That's a lot of money. And they pay how much in taxes? None. They pay no taxes. Second estate, which is your nobility, basically another 1% of the population. The clergy was the other 1%. They own a quarter of France's land. They have a lot of money, a lot of political power, and they pay no taxes. So who's paying all the taxes? Third estate, your peasants and your bourgeoisie. They make up roughly 98% of the French population at this point in time. The bourgeoisie have money because they are bankers, lawyers, doctors, merchants, your skilled craftsmen, your tradesmen, your business owners, but they're paying massive amounts of taxes. And so they can barely stay afloat. And of course, you've got your peasants. Your peasants don't have any money. They're the poorest group in society. They own very little, if nothing. Some of them don't even have a house to live in. A lot of them live in shacks, lean-tos, things like that. They work as servants or farmers, day laborers, and barely make enough to keep a roof over their head. So the third estate's paying all the taxes. They don't have any, they have little political voice at all. And they start getting these ideas, especially the bourgeoisie. They are educated guys. They've heard about the Enlightenment. They start reading about the Enlightenment. And of course, things start to transpire. And like I said, the third estate's paying the majority of the taxes there. This is a political cartoon showing the issues with the first and second estate. They're crushing the third estate with taxes. So, you see the issues that are lying there for France with the inequality in the social system. You've got a king and queen who could care less about how to spend money. They're very slow when it comes to being good leaders. They've had economic trouble. You've got the Enlightenment ideals. So things are about to come to a head. The States General are called in. And as you can see, the voting in the States General is wrong. Each estate gets only one vote. The clergy, the first estate, gets a vote. The nobles, the second estate, gets a vote. And then the third estate, the bourgeoisie and peasants, get one vote. So who do you think always gets outvoted? The third estate. Because the first and second estate will always take care of themselves. But when it comes to political voice, population, and things like that, the third estate should always have the larger vote, but they don't. So, 1789, Louis wants to help with the tax issues, the debt that has grown. And so he's decided he's going to tax the nobility for the first time, and he's got to be able to have the two votes to go against the nobility. And so he actually invites the third estate for the first time since the Middle Ages to come and vote to overcome the nobility. Well, what Louis doesn't know is that the Enlightenment ideals are going around. These people that are part of the third estate and the bourgeoisie that are educated are coming to this estates general with the idea that they're going to get rid of the absolute monarch, they're going to create a parliament, and they are going to be in control of their own government. And so they come and they decide, hey, listen, Kingy, we actually want to create a new vote. We want to change things up. And they insist that all three estates vote together and vote by each person then rather than by group. And so, of course, who's going to outnumber everybody then? The third estate. And this scares the dickens out of the king. Why? Because he knows if they have that many votes and they become that powerful, he's gone, along with many of his other cronies that he was wanting to keep in the loop. And so it really scares him. And he's like, listen, okay, maybe we need to talk about this. Well, the third estate said, that's not all. We're going to proclaim ourselves the National Assembly, their own parliament, and we're going to claim the right to pass laws and reforms in the name of the French people. And guess what? The monarchy's over, buddy. You can go ahead and step down, give us your crown. And so this scares him a little bit, and it gets a little heated there at Versailles between the third estate, the first estate, and the second estate. The clergy, the nobles, they get a little hot with the king, but they mainly get hot with the third estate because they're scared as well. And so the king sends them all home and says, like, listen, guys, let's all go home. Let's think about this. Let's sleep on it. Maybe cooler heads will prevail and we'll come back tomorrow and we'll talk about it. Well, Louis and the first two estates actually lock the third estate out of Versailles the next day so they can't meet. And the third estate representatives break into a tennis court. It's actually like a handball court there at Versailles. And they vow that they will not leave this tennis court until they have a French constitution. And this pledge is known as the tennis court oath. And so you've got all these guys that are mainly a part of the higher third estate. They're educated. They've read the Enlightenment ideals, and they're all standing around with their hands over their heart and their hand in the sky, pledging that they will not leave until they have a French constitution. And so they're standing there talking this out, and they basically are hammering out this French constitution, and Louis finds out about it, and he sends in his mercenary guards shooting up the place because he wants them off the premises, and he don't want them to try to overthrow him, and so he has to disperse them. And here's a picture of them. This is a representation of them standing there, pledging their allegiance to the French people. They would not leave until they had a French constitution. Tennis court oath, very important. Well, word spreads that Louis used the military force to put down this insurrection. More rumors fly that a foreign army is coming to attack Paris. And so people start to defend themselves. They start to gather weapons. But what good are weapons without ammunition and gunpowder at this point in time? And they didn't have a whole lot of that. But they knew somewhere that did. Some of them get the idea that in the middle of Paris was something known as the Bastille. The Bastille was a French armory slash prison where the king took political prisoners there and tortured them. And he also had his armory there. And so they knew that they could go in there and take the weapons that they needed to protect themselves. And so July the 14th, 1789, a mob encompasses the Bastille. They break down the gate. They run into the Bastille. They free the few prisoners that were there, and they get the armaments that they need. But they start something here that is going to carry on over throughout the French Revolution. They kill the commander of the prison and chop his head off and place it on a pike and parade it around town like it's something they won. And this is the start of, the official start of, the French Revolution. So July the 14th, 1789, the French still today celebrate this as Bastille Day. This is their Independence Day. But this also starts a very odd and scary thing that the French has started here. A lot of the Enlightenment thinkers were all about personal freedoms. They were all about the idea that everybody's created equal and everybody has the right to their beliefs. Now, what about that commander's ideas and his beliefs and his equality? Where did that go when they killed him and chopped his head off? Why don't you think about that? Okay? That's going to carry over throughout the whole entire French Revolution, though. A lot of heads are going to be chopped off because of this. But anyway, this is the storming of the Bastille. Very famous. It is no longer there. Why? Because they signed breaking that thing down brick by brick using their bare hands. They actually sold off some of the bricks to fund the revolution. And so the Bastille is gone. But it is their Independence Day, July the 14th. And so, as the revolution begins, this great fear spreads. Spreads across Paris, across the countryside. And this is what's crazy. The peasants start breaking into homes, the nobles' homes all across the countryside. And I understand them destroying the legal papers that require them to pay their feudal taxes like they're still peasants or they're still serfs or something. But then they burnt the homes too. And I'm like, some of y'all are homeless and y'all are burning these beautiful, opulent homes. Why don't you just live in them if y'all are going to, you know, take other people's rights? Because that's what they were doing. If you think about it. They were taking their rights away from them. But still, they didn't use their brains too well on that. And so, further in into the revolution, you get something known as the Women's March. So the issue here, why do the women march? Well, as the revolution continued, the life in Paris is getting worse. They're running out of bread. They're running out of flour. They're running out of this and that. And so they hear that at Versailles, Marie Antoinette has hoarded wheat and grain and flour in order to bake cakes and pastries and stuff for her and her friends, because they're still partying, guys. They're still throwing, they are oblivious to what is happening. They have no idea that their country is going down the toilet, because they could care less, and they're a little slow. And so these women here, these women of Paris, decide to find some weapons, some cannons and other things, and they march on Versailles. And so they get to the gates of Versailles and they protest outside of the gates. Now listen, they're at a breaking point. They still believe that Louis is the absolute ruler of France. They believe still in divine right, that God put him on the throne and only God can take him off. But they are at a breaking point. This is one reason why they don't quite yet run into the palace. They stop at the gates and they protest outside. But it's going to come to a head. And so Louis comes home from a hunting trip and he's like, asking his servants, what's going on, guys? Why is all this going on outside? And, you know, the servants telling him about what's going on, and Louis looks at him and says, listen, is this a revolt? Is this a rebellion? He says, no, it's a revolution, sir. Anyway, while the ladies are out there, and there's men out there too, they hear this rumor. Now, of course, this is one of the biggest rumors that wasn't really true. Here that Marie has thrown another party. And one of the servants asked, well, what about the people outside? And she supposedly had said, let them eat cake. Guys, she would never have said that, because she would have never even paid attention to the people at her front gate. She had no idea that there was poor people in France. She was that oblivious to what was going on. That's how stuck on herself that she was, and how spoiled, rotten little brat that she was, that she could care less about anybody else than herself. And so thousands of women there, they come to a breaking point. Something happened, and anyway, they finally storm Versailles. And Marie runs, grabs her children, and flees to her husband, the king's apartment. Remember, there's thousands of rooms there in Versailles. And he's standing there with his armed guards around them to keep them safe. But these women, they're running through Versailles and they're screaming like banshees. I want her head. I want her arm. I want her leg. If they would have found Marie, they would have tore her to pieces. They got to her room and they tore her room all to pieces and whatnot. And basically, they finally found them. And they forced Louis and Marie and their family into a carriage. And as they're running through the Versailles, though, they kill a baker. They kill some guards there. They chop their heads off. They put makeup on the heads and they put them on pikes. And so the whole way back to Paris, because they are forcing Louis and Marie and their family to basically go live back in Paris under house arrest. The whole way back, though, from Versailles to Paris, it's like a parade with the royal family in the carriage, the people outside parading them back like their trophies, with the armed guards' heads on pikes. Listen, guys, I understand the ideas of the Enlightenment and they're great, but when does it come to a point that you take other people's rights away by chopping their heads off and parading them around town just because they don't believe the same way you do? Doesn't make it right. Anyway, Marie and Louis would never return to Paris. They're eventually going to get their heads chopped off. But they're under house arrest at this point in time in the revolution. So we're going to end the notes here. You will have this set of questions and a reading to go with this. But you've got questions to go with this reading or this set of notes. I want you to get those questions done. And then we will move on to the readings, okay? So, until next time.